Have you ever wondered why some researchers publish in record time while others wait 6 months or even a year for a decision? It's not luck, it's not connection. It's understanding how the system really works, because the truth is journal timelines are not as transparent as they look. You might think you're submitting to a fast journal until you realize that the numbers on the website don't match reality. In this video, I'll show you how to publish both faster and for free without falling into the trap of paying thousands of dollars in open access fees. I'll walk you through the real examples of major publishers like Elsevier and Springer and show you the exact steps I use and I teach within AAA program to get papers accepted in shortest possible time. We'll look at how to read journal timelines correctly, how to identify avenues that accelerate your publication, and how to find thousands of free high-impact journals that don't charge authors a single dollar. I'll also show you a rare example that can lead to miscalculating the processing time of a journal. Let's get started. Hold on a sec. Make sure you like this video and hit the subscribe button to be reminded every time I post a new video. And if you're new here to this channel, my name is Prof. Samira Hosseini. I've guided over 12,000 ambitious academics from struggling with Q1 journal publications, low visibility, and weak citation record to building strong research pipelines, earning global recognition, and establishing themselves as trusted authorities in their field. And I'm here to help you do the same. So, how do we publish fast? One of the best ways to publish faster is to check the journal's processing time. The simplest hack is to open the journal's website and read the timeline box. For today's walkthrough, I'm using the European Polymer Journal. I have several examples that let us explore how processing times can vary from paper to paper. Journal suitability is a different conversation, though. Inside the AAA program, we teach how to validate that a journal is credible, indexed, and not predatory or hijacked. We also check whether the journal is a good investment for your academic future, meaning that the metrics are stable and trending up, not down. That is not the focus of this video, though. Here, we focus purely on time metrics. Let's assume this journal is a fit. It's a Scopus index, safe for publishing. From the general data, the CITES score is 10.2, which is strong, and the impact factor is 6.3, a solid Q1 venue. When you open the website, you will see timing details. It states that the time from submission to the first decision is 13 days. That covers the initial editorial check and whether the paper is desk rejected or sent for peer review. It also states the peer review takes about 40 days, which includes the reviewing time and the editor's decision based on their reports. Altogether, the journal reports an average of 76 days from submission to acceptance, which is efficient on paper. Let's test that against a few real articles from a recent issue of the European Polymer Journal. Example 1 was received on July 4th, 2025, accepted on October 4th, 2025. That is 92 days, which is longer than the reported 76. Example 2, received on July 22, accepted on October 1st. This is 71 days, close to the reported average. Example 3 was received on June 13 and accepted on October 6th. That's 115 days, significantly longer. Across these three, the mean is about 93 days. Compared with the reported 76 days, you are looking at roughly 2 weeks gap. With only three papers, we already see signals that the real processing time can be longer than the website suggests. Why does this happen? A journal website is relatively static. The operation is dynamic. Editorial board rotates, priorities shift, standards evolve, and the workload fluctuates. To understand current timelines, always scan the last issues regularly instead of relying on the website of the journal. And don't limit yourself to three articles. I chose three here to make this video go through faster, but my recommendation is to look into at least 10 articles and get an average for the processing time of the journal. Now, here is a rare example that can mislead if you don't read carefully. A 2014 article of mine shows received on July 26 and accepted on August 7, a 12-day gap. If you saw that in isolation inside the 2025 issue, you might conclude that the journal is ultra fast. Don't let that example fool you. The missing piece is the revision timeline. There is no visible revision date on the record. The backstory matters. The initial decision for this paper was reject and resubmit. In the AAA, we train authors on all possible outcomes after submission. You might see minor revision, major revision, or reject and resubmit. The last one is essentially a major revision that you can address and return, or you can submit elsewhere. My advice is to treat reject and resubmit like a major revision. Respond point by point to every reviewer comment, mark all the changes clearly, and submit with a cover letter that states prior decision and confirms that you have addressed everything. That's exactly what we did. The editors evaluated the revised manuscript and accepted it as submitted. On the public page, the timeline jumps from received to accepted in 12 days. But that does not mean the paper skipped peer review. The real review cycle took us months in 2014. The lesson is due diligence. Check multiple recent papers. If you're facing a grant report deadline, if your students need publications to graduate, or if you're up for promotion in the next 6 months, these timeframes are critical. When you find special cases like reject and resubmit with no visible revision date, exclude them from your turnaround calculation. And here is a reminder. For a realistic estimate, compute submission to acceptance across at least 10 standard papers that shows a revision step. Even our quick 3 paper checks suggest 93, not 76, which already indicates that the real processing time can be longer than what the website suggests. Strategy number 2, consider open access journals, but if only you have the budget to cover the publication fees. Open access journals usually process submissions faster than subscription-based ones. We'll talk about fees later when we discuss pre-publication routes, but here is the main idea. Open access journals work with a built-in sense of urgency because their revenue is tied directly to the accepted papers. They tend to move things along at a faster pace. Still, don't skip the verification step. Use the same method I showed earlier and check the processing times of at least 10 last published articles. Make sure that the actual turnaround matches your expectations before you commit to paying those fees. Strategy 3, and this one can be a real accelerator. Submit to a special issue. Right now, there are thousands of open calls for papers and special issues across top journals. But before jumping in, you need to understand how special issues work and how they differ from regular issues. In a regular issue, your paper is handled by the journal's internal team. It goes first to the editor-in-chief for screening and then one of the associate editors for peer review. In a special issue, things work differently. The editors of a special issue are usually external scholars who propose a thematic issue to the journal. If their proposal is accepted, they become guest editors. The guest editors are responsible for inviting papers, managing reviews, and meeting a publication deadline agreed upon with the journals. Now, here is what most authors don't know. Guest editors face a very strict timeline and pressure. They must attract a set of minimum number of articles, usually around 10, for the issue to move forward. But since they're external to the journal's regular editorial system, they often rely on their personal network to invite submissions. That can be tough. They are new in their role, and they may not have the large mailing list, and yet they must meet the rejection and acceptance ratios, typically rejecting about 70% of the submissions and accepting only 30%. So what happens if they can't meet the requirements? The journal simply cancels the special issue. The papers already accepted are honored, but they'll be published in regular issues instead. And that is a serious loss for the guest editors. Why? Because the real academic credit doesn't come from the invited accepted papers. It comes from the editorial note that would appear on the top of the published special issue. That editorial note appears as a separate index article under their name, complete with a DOI. If the issue is canceled, there is no editorial note and no credit for their work either. So imagine this. My colleagues and I propose a special issue. We need 10 accepted papers to finalize it. After weeks of outreach, we managed to attract only 3. The journal thanks us for the effort, but cancels the issue. Those 3 accepted papers get published in a regular issue, and all of the work and the effort that we put disappears without recognition. That's why guest editors are often under immense pressure to fill their issue and will be open to receiving suitable manuscript and process them efficiently and fast. For authors, this creates an opportunity. If you find a special issue that perfectly matches your topic, it can be one of the fastest routes for publication. Here is my strongest recommendation. Always check the background of the guest editors before you submit. Recently, some special issues have faced retractions because guest editors accepted low-quality papers or failed to detect methodological flaws. Even though the editor-in-chief supervises the overall process, these lapses can still happen. So before you send your manuscript, look up the guest editors. Are they experienced researchers? Do they have several publications in your field and their own papers? Are they well-cited and reputable? If the answer is yes, you can be confident that your article will receive a serious, fair, and timely evaluation. Special issues can be an incredible shortcut to publication, but only when you choose them wisely. By the way, if you want the link to these 2,454 calls for papers for special issues, just drop the word call in the comment below and I'll send you the link. Now let's move to the free part, how to publish without paying. That's actually quite straightforward once you understand the two main types of journals that exist. The first group is subscription-based journals. In this model, the readers or the institutions pay. Universities and research centers purchase annual subscriptions from publishers so their members can access all the articles. If you're using your institutional login to read Elsevier, Springer, or Wiley papers, that's because your university already pays that subscription fee. The second group is open access journals. Here, it's the authors who pay instead of the readers. When you publish open access, you return the copyright and your article becomes freely available to anyone in the world. No paywall, no login required. But this visibility comes with a price. Open access publication fees usually starts around $2,000 USD and can go all the way to $5,000 or $6,000 depending on the journal. If you have a grant or the institutional fund that covers this cost, it can be a great investment. Open access can dramatically increase your paper's reach and accessibility. However, if you don't have that kind of budget, there is good news. You don't have to pay anything to publish. Most journals today are hybrid, meaning they support both routes, subscription and open access. You can publish in the same journal without paying and your article will still appear in Scopus and Web of Science just like any other paper. Let's look at the numbers. Within Elsevier, there are over 3,000 journals and about 819 of them, roughly 30%, are fully open access. The remaining 70% are hybrid. For Springer Nature, the pattern is pretty much similar. They also have around 3,000 journals and only about 700, which is 23%, are fully open access. The other 77% follow the hybrid model. So when you hear people say, you can't publish without paying, remember, that's simply not true. Around 3/4 of journals let you publish free of charge through the subscription route. Now, how do you check which type your target journal is? Usually, that's right there on the journal's homepage. Take a look at the European Polymer Journal as an example again. Right under the title, you will see a label that says supports open access. That means it's a hybrid journal. You can choose to pay and make your paper open access or publish free under the subscription system. If you scroll down, you see the open access fee is $4,520 USD. Pretty steep, but again, that's optional. The subscription-based publication comes with no charge for authors, and the paper becomes immediately available for all institutional subscribers. Now, compare that with a strictly open access journal, for instance, Computational and Structural Biotechnology Journal. Right below the title, you will see open access only, no subscription option, and the article processing charge is $3,230 US. So unless you have a grant or your university specifically allocates open access funds, it's perfectly fine to go with subscription-based journals. When I used to lead a faculty development unit, I had a dedicated open access budget. Our policy was simple. If the journal offered a free route, we never paid. But if an article had exceptional potentials, for example, it aligned with the institutional priorities or carried high visibility, then we approved open access funding. Those cases are rare and strategic. Remember, visibility is not the same as accessibility. The number of citations you earn is not determined by whether your article is open access. It's determined by how you position it, the keywords, your research network, your collaborations, and the promotion strategies you use. These are exactly the strategies we teach inside the AAA program, where our mentees routinely achieve high citation impact without paying thousands in publication fees. So now you know how to publish faster, avoid unnecessary fees, and make smarter journal choice. The truth is, once you understand how the publication system really works, you stop waiting for luck and you start working with precision. Inside the AAA program, this is exactly what we do. We teach academics how to build a publication pipeline that runs on strategy, not chance. You'll learn how to target journals that fit your goals, structure papers that get accepted, and grow your H index with purpose. If you are ready to accelerate your academic growth and start publishing at the level you truly deserve, book a free call with me. We'll look at where you are, what's holding you back, and map out the fastest route to your next accepted paper. The link is right below this video. I can't wait to meet you there. And don't forget this video on detecting signs of predatory journals so you can stay safe from making monumental mistakes. If you found this helpful, make sure you like this video so it reaches more researchers who are struggling with the same challenges. Share it with your colleagues or students, because when academics share knowledge, the entire community grows stronger. And don't forget to subscribe. Every week, I post data-driven insights on publication, academic leadership, and building a career that goes well beyond citations. Your next breakthrough might just come from the next episode.